President Ramaphosa, Jacob Zuma's successor, yesterday addressed the nation's parliament, saying that he wanted to heal the nation's divisions by taking land from white farmers and giving it to black farmers, which should clear up any racial resentments on both sides. As you can imagine, this has stirred up more emotion than overdosing on estrogen, with people calling it everything from a white genocide to reparations. Today I'm going to look into what's actually happening, as I'm hearing radically different reports from all of the secondary news sources I'm reading. Because only two types of people seem to be reporting on this: angry white people and Russian propaganda stations. And it is never a good sign when Russia Today might actually be the better source. So first, what happened?
Now, the National Assembly, meanwhile, has passed a motion on land expropriation without compensation tabled by the EFF. The process will now be taken to the Constitutional Review Committee as part of looking at the possible amendment of Section 25 of the Constitution.
Who knew stealing land was so boring when you're going through all of the legal minutiae? Too bad you can't just do a British style where you plant a flag and hope no one understands what's going on for a few generations. So anyways, the piece of news everybody in the West heard about was that the South African Parliament has passed a motion to amend Section 25 of their constitution to allow for the seizure of land without financial compensation. So this brings us to today, because this is about as much a done deal as President Zuma's conviction. The next step is it needs to be reviewed by the Constitutional Review Committee. Wow, the Constitutional Review Committee reviews the Constitution? You don't say! Most people believe this will happen on or before March 30th. Alright, so what is this Constitutional Review Committee? Well, it's a 24-member team that reads over proposed amendments to make sure they're constitutionally viable and make amendments to the amendments where things might differ. The odd thing is, what they were submitted was less of a proposed amendment and more of a writing project. Because after talking about the apartheid and unfairly distributed land for a page and a half, as if these well-read judges weren't sure that South Africa has a unique history of brutal dispossession of land from black people by the settler colonial white minority, it ends with a request to the committee asking, review Section 25 of the Constitution and other clauses where necessary to make it possible for the state to expropriate land in the public interest without compensation. Alright. So what passed in Parliament was less of an amendment and more homework that even comes with a deadline. Report to the Assembly by no later than August 30th, 2018. Alright, so this raises another question. What does the Constitution currently say about land acquisition? Because, let me tell you, the amendment request is a radical departure from what is currently there. After reading all of Section 25, which is a little over a page, it becomes immediately apparent that you're probably going to have to cross that whole thing out to make this work. Because it starts by saying, no one may be deprived of property except in terms of law of general application, and no law may permit arbitrary deprivation of property. And then it goes on to describe how all land seized must be paid for either by an agreed upon price or a price set by the court. This amendment basically says, yeah, I like what you did there, but let's do the exact opposite. See how that works. Honestly, I expected this amendment request to be a little more subtle than something I would expect to see attached to a brick and thrown through a window. But there really isn't much room for interpretation in this case. So let's talk about this proposal a little more. First, why now? I mean, the president just got thrown out on corruption charges. Most people would want to kind of tap on the brakes before giving the government more power. Well, and this is coming from the skeptics. According to South African newspaper News 24, some think that this is a move to show voters, sure, our government has been so corrupt that a politician actually got caught, which, wow, does that barely ever happen, but we can still do what's in your best interest by taking away white people's land and giving it to you. Other people would argue that it relies on this man, Cyril Ramaphosa, ex-President Zuma's replacement. A year ago, the same amendment was proposed by the Economic Freedom Fighters. And as you can probably guess by their name, they're not the most easy to compromise with political party. But It failed when then-President Jacob Zuma, leader of the African National Congress, refused to give it the more than 50% of the votes that are controlled by his party. And let's be real, there's no way Jacob Zuma wanted anyone looking into who owns what property. Otherwise, we'd probably find out that Zuma's mansion was actually a Gupta Airbnb. Because of the way power is distributed in this system, there would be no way for this to pass without the support of the African National Congress, which led to a huge break for the leader of the economic freedom fighters, Julius Malema, when Zuma was replaced by someone a little more radical. Now, Cyril Ramaphosa has backed to Julius Malema's proposal, but there's one other major minority party that unanimously voted against it. The Democratic Alliance, which doesn't have enough seats to threaten the passage of this proposal, but it does have enough seats to make it not unanimous, which I guess is just one. I mean, they do control just under a quarter of the 400 seat parliament, making them the largest thing to be rendered entirely powerless since Blockbuster Video. So what is the argument for this land deal? Well, I can quote the proposal saying, "A recent land audit claims that black people own less than 2% of rural land and less than 7% of urban land, and considering black people make up more than 80% of the population, well, something's wrong with that picture. The question is, how do you resolve it?" Well, as we mentioned earlier, the economic freedom fighters, who might want to look up what freedom is in the dictionary because it's certainly not the government control and redistribution of property, think that the current policy instruments, including the willing buyer, willing seller policy and other provisions of Section 25 of the Constitution, may be hindering effective land reform. Which, if you're complaining that people's constitutionally recognized basic rights are holding back your plans, you might want to take a second look at your plans. That would be a cost-effective way of redistributing land, though, a problem that seems to be plaguing South Africa. Morality aside, there are a few logistical hiccups people are worried about. If this amendment were to go through, first, we saw something similar to this happen in Zimbabwe. And if there's a country you don't want to base your economic stability on, it's Zimbabwe.
We will die clinging to our land.
Back in 1999, Zimbabwe took farmland from white people and redistributed it back to blacks. Only problem, a lot of those people who got the farms didn't have any experience in agriculture, so what was once a surplus agricultural economy had to, years later, get bailed out by the international food aid organizations. It wasn't really successful, and it's not just me saying that. Here's the leader of the economic freedom fighters.
Those who are saying we are like Zimbabwe, they are alarmists. Even in Zimbabwe, if it was done properly, I don't think they would have experienced what they have experienced. The white people and investors had a problem with the beating, had a problem with the killings which were happening in the country.
Now, don't get me wrong, beatings and killings aren't the best way of achieving a public relations victory, but that wasn't what hurt the food production. This is assuming that the white people are gonna just voluntarily leave their farms and let the government give it to blacks without any compensation. And if you think that's a stupid thing for me to say, because clearly that won't happen.
We're now beginning to get calls from white people who are saying, "We agree, we must just be taken along. We need to get an assurance that we are not a target." So it is done through a democratic process, is done through a constitution.
Ah yes, the democratic process of surrendering your land to a government to avoid being a target. The other threat we see is that this will devastate the real estate market in South Africa. This government seizure of land raises two interesting questions. First is an operational one. You see, if you want to take land from landowners, you got yourself some competition. Big banks. Farms in South Africa owe a lot of money to banks, so if the government takes your land and gives it to someone else, who gets the debt? In most of these cases, a South African bank might own the land about as much as the white farmer. So it'll be interesting to see how this gets handled in the final proposals. The other is a more interesting question of whether advocating for the government seizing land from white people and giving it to blacks will hurt investment in the country. Not just for moral reasons, but also because white people make up a fair amount of investors. And if you can seize their property without paying anything just because they're white, all of a sudden that Nigerian prince isn't looking like that bad of an investment. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this last video. Slam that subscribe button for more episodes going over South Africa. And as always, thank you for watching.